Any discussion about the world's greatest event planners has to begin and will probably end with Dean Stockwall. Mm. He's orchestrated parties on every continent on Earth, including Antarctica. His new book, Dean of the New School, hits the bookshelves this fall. And it goes into the way that you put together these events, why you put them together, and a little bit of your kind of history. Dean, thanks so much for joining us this evening.
Well, thank you so much for having me, David.
Tell me, I'm curious how it was that you came to embrace a more kind of mystical side of event planning.
Mm. Well, it's kind of crazy because I was on a bus, and I can't remember the last time I took public transportation, but my car had broken down, and I thought, what the hell? And I'm on the bus and looking around, and because I'm always observing, and I saw these Russian ladies, I saw some Korean kids, I saw Ethiopians, I love them. Mm-hmm. That's when I got this image in my head of a map of the world, thinking about all these different kinds of people, and there are dots on this map. These dots all start moving around, and the oldest one on this image in my head is from 1922 because that represents the oldest person on the bus. And as the image grew in my head, more and more dots appeared on the map, and more dots started to move because now people are moving on to different countries. They're immigrating, if you will. They're going on to vacation, going off to college, being deployed to the military, right? Mm-hmm. So all of a sudden the dots start to move, and as time progresses and comes forward, the dots start to converge onto one place, and that place would be Los Angeles. They're all on this bus together, mm-hmm. all of us. Now it's not going to be long, as you know, maybe 5, 10, 15 minutes before those dots will start to scatter and move again, right? Mm-hmm. But what did we share? We shared that exact same moment at that exact same place at that exact same time. Mm-hmm. And you can never take that away from any of us. Now that's what got me thinking about this mystical side of event planning, as you asked. I want my events to be more than just an empty gathering. Mm-hmm. I want them to be a convergence of souls. Mm-hmm. And the people who occupy them can feel a presence and a connection to other people. And a connection that just doesn't go away right away. Because people tend to want to connect and then we so briefly are there before we move on. I say, let's stay connected.
So give us a few examples of this. What does this actually mean in practice?
Let's go with the Sultan of Brunei's graduation party, okay? Mm-hmm. Each guest, and these are guests from all over the world, obviously, was implanted with a microchip. And that microchip was put right in the middle of their back. And each one of those microchips had a partner chip, if you will, okay, that was implanted into another random party guest. Okay. So now you've got these two people that are connected to each other by these chips, but they don't know it. Mm-hmm. Now, when the party is over, and by the way, this could be, you know, really depends on our mood. Could be a couple of days after, it could be weeks or months, it could be a decade after the party, two of the partner chips are suddenly and simultaneously activated, causing an extreme amount of pain uh-huh. in that person, particularly in the middle of the back, yeah. but really their whole body is hurting.
Okay.
And in order to turn off that pain, they have to find their chip's partner chip, press their bodies up against each other, and then the chips will feel the proximity to each other, and the pain will finally go away.
Hmm.
They have to not only learn how to sort of connect with each other at that party, but then how do we stay accessible to each other so we can find each other after the party and turn off that pain?
So have you kept up with this? Have any of these chips been activated?
Absolutely. We actually have what we call the command center,
yeah.
right?
Okay.
And we activate them from the command center. It's really just an office.
But yeah.
We had Angela Merkel, mm-hmm. okay? She had to be flown out of the G8 summit last year. You probably read about that.
Yeah, under mysterious circumstances from what I remember.
They're gonna be mysterious no more.
Yeah.
What happened was, you didn't read that she was flown directly to Cinque Terre uh-huh. to be pressed up against Colin Hanks, who had to put a movie on hold because his chip had been activated. They were partner chips. And they had a great time together. They had a wonderful reunion. Yeah. And I doubt that they would have gotten together after the party had it not been for those chips.
It's a really beautiful image. Colin Hanks and Angela Merkel just pressed up each other, and like the crazy relief they must have felt.
Yeah.
To be
well, they're probably smiling, I'll tell you that, after that much pain.
Yeah.
We do a lot of fun stuff like that.
Dean, a lot of the events that you write about in here are enormous productions, a lot of people involved. There's a lot on the line, and some of them are very risky, and I'm sure things inevitably fall apart.
Well, it does happen. Not always, thank goodness, but it does happen, and we all know that that's a risk, and we all know we're walking a tightrope, but that tightrope is what helps us really focus and hone in. And I think a lot of really magical things happen when things fall apart. Mm-hmm. I don't think the brain functions any better than when it's in a blind panic. We did a Westworld-themed bachelor party for Elon Musk. It was an unmitigated disaster from start to finish. Now, part of that was the fact that I had a new assistant at the time, but also, it's pretty well documented that Elon Musk is notoriously an unstable young man. Let's be frank. So we built an entire Westworld-themed ghost town from scratch in Jalisco, Mexico, okay? And we populated it with android cowboys. And one thing led to another. And looking back, I should have watched Westworld all the way through.
Oh, you didn't see the whole thing.
I did not. And I should have before I committed to this because, well, I don't know. I don't like to stare at the past. Let's just look at it briefly, right?
Yeah.
Otherwise, we don't learn. We don't move forward. Well, of course, the cowboys had real guns. Of course, the guns were loaded with real ammunition. And of course, it became a nightmare very quickly.
Yeah.
But what I found surprising, David, was that Elon Musk murdered way more party guests than the malfunctioning robots.
Wow, that is surprising.
Yeah, and he got no bad press for that. I guess anything goes in Mexico, right?
Yeah, wow. It's shocking.
This
town still stands in Jalisco?
Oh, yeah. The town is there. Absolutely. You can go see it.
Yeah.
Real Mexicans are now moving into that town.
Yeah.
Honest to goodness, human Mexicans.
They're repopulating the ghost town.
They are.
That's cool.
Elon was very happy with the event, surprisingly.
Yeah.
Wants me to do another event. I keep graciously declining, but he keeps calling.
I mean, I'm glad he was happy with the way things turned out. But yeah, that's shocking.
Oh, yeah. I've never murdered anyone, but I would just imagine after murdering someone, I wouldn't feel too good. Yeah.
It'd be rough.
Maybe the more you murder, the less you feel it.
That's what I've heard more.
So really? So you've heard that?
Maybe that's where Elon's at.
Yeah, that could be.
Psychologically. You did a birthday party for one of my favorite singers, Adam Levine. And I had friends that were there, and they told me a little bit about it afterwards. And they said it was a really surreal, like, brutal experience.
Well, yes, but honestly, it didn't start off that way. One of the great things about my line of work is that even if you have a very detailed and well-conceived plan, and you have a team that executes things to a T 99% of the time, the event is at some point going to take on a life of its own. And you better get on the train and go for the ride.
I bet. One of the things that they really enjoyed was a fountain of tears.
That was so beautiful. And that was Adam's idea. That wasn't even my idea.
Yeah.
You're really lucky when you have a client that knows what his guests will love and what they will be profoundly moved by. Fountain of Tears was difficult. We had to source 200 gallons of human tears. We found a place to do that in El Salvador. Kind of up against the gun, though. The tears got held up in customs for weeks.
Yeah.
So we had cat tears as a backup, but that wasn't Adam's vision.
Yeah.
So we certainly wanted to make sure we could get the human tears if possible. Long story short, got the tears in, mixed them with the grain alcohol, poured them into the fountain. And you know, I had always heard the phrase drunk on tears as a metaphor,
yeah.
But to see it materialize,
yeah.
Beautiful.
So this fountain, people drank out of this fountain.
Oh, the fountain was bone dry by the end of the night. If the fountain would have been the main attraction, that would have been okay. The fountain was the star. Mm-hmm. Adam wanted to try something, and it just didn't go over that well. And, you know, I'm the event planner, the designer, if you will, the quarterback, and I have to take one on the chin sometimes. Mm-hmm. Everybody came into the backyard for the events. By the way, this is his estate in Montecito. It is palatial. A full menagerie in the backyard.
Oh, that's what I heard. Yeah, like on the grounds, they these animals.
Yeah, know, like a zoo.
Cruise around, yeah.
Right, but you know that makes sense with him, I think. Mm-hmm. So anyway, everyone had to come by the Fountain of Tears. So far, so good, right? And then they're walking into the middle of the backyard, and there's a cage. Mm-hmm. Now it looks like a bird cage, but the cage is about 15 feet high, and guess who's inside of the cage?
I'm going to say Adam.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Shirtless. Pacing back and forth like some sort of an animal, right? Probably one of his cats. And I'm thinking, what the hell is he doing? Mm-hmm. And suddenly, when all the guests arrive, they're of course all gathered around the cage. And Michael Buffer, the Let's Get Ready to Rumble guy, he announces to all of the guests, tonight and tonight only, all bets are off with Adam Levine. Do whatever you want and there will be no consequences. So, you know, I don't do a great impersonation of it, but something like that. Yeah. And all the guests look confused, but now Adam, once again, is verbally accosting people. Now he's spitting on people.
He's just egging everybody on.
Yeah, he's egging them on. Egging them on, picking up whatever he can, throwing them at the guests, spitting at the guests. Well, they're confused.
Yeah.
I'm confused. We're all confused.
Of course.
Really? We can do whatever we want to Adam mm-hmm. on his birthday in this cage? Mm-hmm. Well, finally, this kid, this 13-year-old kid or some teenager from X Factor, God, I don't know his name, who the hell watches that show, but they open up the cage, he gets in there and starts pushing Adam. Mm-hmm. And then they start slapping each other. Well, now I'm in, mm-hmm. right? And I'm watching them slap each other. And suddenly this kid rears back and kicks Adam in the nuts. Mm-hmm. And he falls to the ground. He's writhing in pain. The kid just starts laughing and walks out of the cage. Mm-hmm. I'm like, what the hell is going on? And I thought, oh, Adam is into public humiliation. Mm-hmm. And I'm not going to judge anybody. We all have our things. So mm-hmm. come to find out, that wasn't the case.
So what was the rationale behind this birdcage stunt?
Here's the rationale. I can kick anybody's ass who comes into this cage with me. Mm.
So he just thought he was like a fit guy. He could just take anybody on. And that's what he wanted to do on his birthday, is fight his friends.
Yeah, and when you look at him, he's all tatted up. He's got a great body. You know, I would think he could take anybody too. Yeah. But it was very apparent that he couldn't. And it got dark real fast.
Yeah.
Particularly when Toni Morrison got in there and beat the hell out of him. Mm. And then everybody else rushes the cage.
Yeah, I saw a little quick cell phone video that my friends had taken. And, mm-hmm. and I think at that point, they'd freed the animals from the menagerie, and so there were just wild animals roaming the grounds, and there was just a kind of a sort of sick parade of people just dragging his body behind them.
Yeah.
I think he had passed out by that point, and it was crazy. There were, you know, the things were on fire.
No,
it was
really
savage.
Then it got quiet. It was almost as if they all realized what they had just done. Mm-hmm. And they were ashamed, and they were abashed. And but David, there is something to be said about the regret and shame that they felt, because the guilt of that evening is something that connects these people, mm-hmm. like we were talking about earlier, and it will keep them connected for the rest of their life. Mm-hmm. They share a burden collectively. God, that's beautiful.
And that's the hallmark of a Dean Stockwall event.
You got it.
So what happened to Adam? Is he okay physically?
Well, now he is. Uh-huh. Yeah, we had to take him to the hospital. It was a little touch and go for a while. He was on a ventilator for maybe 2 hours, but he just texted me in the green room before I came out here. I should have brought my phone. He has a picture of a marlin that he just caught. He's on his yacht in Cabo, and it's a big fish.
Yeah, they get huge.
Oh yeah, it's a record one too, of course. He just caught a record fish, just like that, boom. He's on the yacht with Stephen Sondheim, so they're having fun, I'm sure.
So obviously he's doing great.
Doing great.
Yeah. Dean, thank you.
You're welcome.
It's great to have you.
Great
Dean
to be
Stockwall,
here.
Dean of the New School, hits the bookshelves this fall. Be sure to check it out. Do you mind if I play a song to take us out?
I would love that.
There is a water so heavy, it rises up dark from the ocean and arches out over the shoreline and crashes down onto the sand, ripping the boardwalk from its foundation. Know that I, who have loved you, climb to the top of the cedar and watch as the branches below me were sheared by the bodies of dolphins, the cars and the light poles that were swept by the water. All the schools and the churches, the parking lot where I had met you, carried away from the city and washed to the foot of the mountains, to where the ocean ran up against them. There is a water so heavy, it rises up dark from the ocean and arches out over the shoreline, crashes down onto the sand, ripping the boardwalk from its foundation.